Hello everyone. Today we will discuss one of the highly tested topics, diuretics. Before going to the pharmacology part, we will discuss about the physiology in short. If you want, you can skip this part. Here we have our nephron, the unit of kidney mainly responsible for production of urine in order to get rid of excess water and toxic waste products. There are approximately 1 million nephrons in each kidney. At this end of the nephron, blood enters in via afferent arteriole and passed through a network of capillaries called glomerulus and leaves via the efferent arteriole. As this occurs, components of the blood filtered out into an area known as Bowman's capsule. The filtered components collectively known as glomerular filtrate, which pass into the tubules, eventually enters the last part, the collecting duct, and exists as urine. Human kidney typically produce about 180 liters per day. Of this filtrate, yet only 1 to 2 liters of urine are produced each day. This means only 1% of the filtrate manages to leave the nephrons. So what happens to the other 99%? For the most part, filtrate is reserved back into the blood at several locations along the tubule. But how the reabsorption occurs? Well, the efferent arteriole doesn't just end there. It branches out to form capillaries which surrounded the tubules of the nephron. Reabsorption is the movement of substances out of the tubules across the surrounding interstitial fluid into the blood of the capillaries. There is another thing called secretion, which occurs in small amounts in the nephron. This is the process whereby substances move from blood through the interstitial fluid into the tubules. Let's zoom in the first part of the journey where filtration occurs. This is an introductory video I am going to explain in detail in future videos. Basically, most components of the blood, except for blood cells and majority of the proteins, are squeezed out between the pores of the glomerulus to reach the Bowman's capsule. So, the glomerular filtrate contains substances such as water, glucose, amino acid, and inorganic ions such as sodium chloride, potassium, and bicarbonate. It also contains waste products like creatinine and urea. Small amounts of these substances in the blood are okay, but they are harmful in large doses, hence the body rids itself of significant amounts via the kidneys. The next destination for the filtrate is the proximal convoluted tubule. Convoluted simply means twisted or coiled. This region is lined by simple cuboidal epithelium, and substances pass from apical side to the basolateral side of the cells out into the interstitial fluid. Approximately 65% of sodium ions are reabsorbed here through various methods. As we all know, positive attracts negative. So naturally, wherever sodium ions go, chloride ions follow. Other negative ions do so too. As you may know, sodium chloride is the formula of common table salt. So it would be pretty salty outside the tubule if it wasn't for the fact that 65% of the water leaves by osmosis. So water also faithfully follows the sodium and chloride ion. 65% of the potassium is reabsorbed, as well as 90% of the bicarbonate ions, which are important in maintaining the pH of the blood. But glucose and amino acids are reabsorbed around 100% back into the blood to be used in the process such as respiration and making proteins. Here I would like to mention that not all the urea leaves the nephron in the urine, as about 50% is reabsorbed. Ammonia as well as various medications are secreted into the tubule. Now let's discuss about the pharmacology part. In this video, we'll discuss about the drugs which act on proximal convoluted tubule. Before going to that part, two terms should be clear: natriuresis and diuresis. Natriuresis means increased loss of sodium in urine. So any substances which increase the sodium loss in urine is called natriuretic agent. And diuresis means increased urine output. So any agent which increase the urine output is called diuretic agent. Here I have drawn a proximal convoluted tubule cell. As we have already discussed that the side towards the lumen is called luminal side and the opposite side is basolateral side. Numerous proteins are present in both sides as they are both lipid bilayer membrane. The proteins are basically different transporters or channels. The important thing you have to remember that the proteins present in different sides are structurally and functionally different. So basically the luminal and basolateral sides have different functions. As we previously discussed that 65% sodium are reserved back to the blood through proximal convoluted tubule. So sodium molecule has to pass through the luminal membrane, then basolateral membrane, and finally reserved back to the circulation. Sodium molecule is a positively charged molecule. As we know that the charged and bulky molecule cannot cross the lipid bilayer by simple diffusion. They need a special transporter. Along with sodium, bicarbonate also filtered in Bowman's capsule. Bicarbonate is alkaline in nature. It has to be reserved back to the blood, otherwise our normal acid-base balance will be hampered. So bicarbonate also reserved back to the circulation along with sodium. These two reservations are associated with each other. Let's see how it works. This luminal side has a special transporter which takes one sodium molecule into the cell and concurrently throws out one hydrogen ion out of the cell into the lumen. So transport the sodium and hydrogen ion in different direction. Hydrogen ion is also called proton. So the name of the transporter is sodium proton counter transporter or sodium hydrogen exchanger. Now the other thing you should know that the intercellular area always very poor in sodium. Or in other words, the concentration of sodium in intercellular area is very less. There is a reason for that. There are special transporters on the basolateral side which constantly throw the sodium out of the cells. These transporters on the basolateral side throws 3 sodium out of the cells and 2 potassium into the cells. During this process, they use ATP. That's why the transporter is called sodium potassium ATPase. Here, one thing you should remember that not only proximal convoluted tubule cells, those transporters are present on the basolateral side of every nephron cell. Now, as we already discussed, that in exchange of sodium ion, protons are secreted into the lumen of proximal convoluted tubule. This hydrogen ion binds with the bicarbonate molecule and forms carbonic acid. There is another important enzyme present in the luminal membrane called carbonic anhydrase. This enzyme breaks this carbonic acid into water and carbon dioxide. Carbon dioxide is lipid soluble, so they resorb back into the intracellular area. This carbon dioxide then binds with the intracellular water and forms carbonic acid again. The enzyme involved in this process is again carbonic anhydrase. As it is present intracellularly, so we'll call it intracellular carbonic anhydrase, and the other one is luminal carbonic anhydrase. This carbonic acid breaks down into hydrogen and bicarbonate. This bicarbonate grows out of the cells with a special transporter in exchange of chloride ion. This bicarbonate reaches to the interstitial area and finally goes back to the circulation. Now, if we block the carbonic anhydrase enzyme, what will happen? It will not be able to break the carbonic acid, so carbon dioxide will not be generated. If carbon dioxide is not there, then intracellular carbonic acid will not form and there will be a deficiency of proton also. As we discussed that the sodium ion is reabsorbed in exchange of hydrogen ion. So the function of the sodium proton counter transporter or exchanger will be altered, and sodium absorption will be hampered. So more sodium will come out in the urine. Excess sodium in the urine cause natriuresis. Bicarbonate will also spill out in the urine. As we know, water follows the ions, so there will be diuresis also. Due to bicarbonate, the urine will be alkaline. Here I would like to mention that the other part of the nephron also absorbs sodium, so the natriuresis and diuresis will be mild in nature. Another substance which can also alter the resorption of sodium is adenosine. Adenosine is released as a result of hypoxia and ATP consumption. It has four different receptors and complex effects on sodium transporters in several segments of the nephron. It can stimulate the sodium hydrogen exchanger and increase the absorption of sodium. The group of drugs that block this carbonic anhydrase enzyme are called carbonic anhydrase inhibitors. Carbonic anhydrase inhibitors further divided into two groups. One group of drugs which can be used systemically like acetazolamide, diclofenamide and methazolamide. And other group of drugs can be used topically like brinzolamide and dorzolamide. Thank you very much for your attention. Please don't forget to subscribe.